Your Story with Melinda Estabrooks, an exclusive presentation of Faith Strong Today.
Well, welcome to another show with me here in the studio on Your Story with Melinda. My guest today, I am thrilled to have here. The first time I saw her was at a conference in Toronto called She Speaks. And when I was listening to her, I was overcome. I was inspired. I was crying. She is a force to be reckoned with. She is formidable and fierce. Cheryl Nemhard is my guest today. And I've been wanting her to be here on the show, and finally I have her. Cheryl is an established playwright, a director, a composer, and filmmaker. She has worked with troubled youth, former gang members, ex-drug addicts, rape survivors, teenage mothers, and more. And her husband, her and Greg, founded Exousia, a media group that addresses issues of fatherlessness and those in sex trafficking. Her heart is for those that are marginalized and hurting. And we're going to talk about her story and what she's doing today in the Toronto area. So Cheryl.
Yes.
Thank you for being here in studio. I'm so glad that you're here.
Thank you for having me. Yes. I'm so excited.
Sisters. And you know, yeah. We were saying that too, that there is something, when I saw you at that conference, I just felt this connection, and I've been wanting you to be
too.
Here for so long.
Yeah, it's so good to be here.
Thank you. So, when I was listening to your story, and you know, even just in the introduction, that you've had a heart for those that are really marginalized, that society deems like tough,
yeah,
you know, tough groupings of people.
Yeah.
But it must come from a place of something personal, because usually when you work with people like that, it's because either you've been there or you have a heart for them or something's happened. So let's start with your story.
Yeah.
From the beginning, and let's go with that and hear about you.
Well, I always like to say that God has called me to touch the untouchable and love the unlovable, because I once was the untouchable and I felt like the unlovable. And my life is definitely a testimony of God's redemption and grace. And I try to extend that every day of my life. I understand that pain because I've lived it personally. From the age of 5 to the age of 12, I was sexually molested. It was a time that really sort of spiraled me into darkness, and I stayed in that darkness for many years. I think what was hard for me, and I always like to share this in faith circles because I think it's something we need to talk about, is that my abuser actually was my Sunday school teacher, and it really had twisted my perception of God and of faith. And beautiful, huge life lesson that I learned that I'd love to share with the listeners is that sometimes we view God through the lens of his people. And so if God's people hurt us, that's God hurting us. If God's people let us down, God has let us down, when he is nowhere involved in those actions. You know, man has free will, man is flawed, full of sin. And so I had a wrong perception of God.
Right from the beginning.
From the beginning. I hated God, I'll be honest with you. I had an absolute hatred for God and for church and church people. And that stemmed from the abuses that I was suffering under the hand of my Sunday school teacher. That spiraled me into a world of what I would sort of sum up as trying to numb the pain. And so in numbing the pain, I delved into alcohol, into drugs, became an alcoholic at the age of 12 and a half, which is unreal. Started dabbling in drugs at the age of 13. Still couldn't numb the pain and the neglect and the absolute devastation that I was experiencing through the abuse. So I joined a gang. And I joined a gang because at the time, I wanted so desperately to feel like I was part of a family. And it's interesting because when I work with gang members, that is, it's an absolute equation. I was a fatherless young girl. I grew up with a single parent. No brothers, no sisters. So it was a very lonely existence for me as an only child. And I so desperately wanted to feel like I belonged somewhere, that there was a group that would protect me. If there's a need for, especially girls who have been abused, there's this never-ending thirst to feel safe, to feel safe and protected. And so I joined this gang under this false pretense of family, false pretense of security. And it turned out to just go from bad to worse.
Now, Cheryl, when you join a gang, how does that happen? Because I'm always fascinated, like, do they just come to you, they befriend you, and they say, hey, come join our girls group? Or what does that mean? What does that look like?
Well, this gang was more sort of regulated to where I lived. And so I lived near government housing. It was a very tough area. And it was just a gang that was sort of in the area at the time. And I just started to hang out every mm-hmm. day, And you just start to roll with them. And in order to, for girls, you know, to be initiated, you had to sort of do something that was crime-based. And so I, you know, show bravery. And I just did that and made my way in. I was heartless. I was full of anger. And you see, I was the poster child. If you sort of looked up the Webster Dictionary for anger and rage, you would have seen my picture. So I had no problem inflicting pain on others because I too was hurt, and hurt people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So when I see someone, so that's good for us to know that, because mm-hmm. a lot of times when we react to young people who are angry and you're like, what is going on?
Yeah.
It's because they're angry. They've been hurt, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and anger can be so misinterpreted, and we mistreat anger. You know, it's misdiagnosed and mistreated. So we respond with anger, we isolate people, we punish people. And sometimes when kids are displaying anger at an early age, it's really a red flag of something else going on. Mm-hmm. And so everything I was doing was a cry for help. But in this gang, you know, the Bible says there's no honor among thieves. So there really wasn't. There was no trust, there was no keeping of your word, there was no value system, and there was a young boy who liked me at the time, kept trying to sort of get at me, and I would reject him. I wasn't interested. I just wanted to do what I was doing, mm-hmm. and one sort of public event, it was like a party, and I shut him down pretty embarrassingly, I would say. Mm-hmm. My girls were there. I was feeling pretty good about myself, and I just shut him down. There was a lot of laughter. I made fun of him, and the next day, he had come to my townhouse, and he said, you know, I'm really sorry about what happened. I'm sorry that I pushed myself on you, because he had kind of forced himself on me. I just want to apologize, and I just want us to kind of be cool. Can I come in and talk? I said, you know, my mom's working. She was a nurse, and so she works all kinds of shifts, night shifts, day shifts, double shifts, trying to put food on the table. And I said, you know, my mom's not home, and it's not a good time. He says, it's just going to be 5 minutes. I just want to apologize. I feel so bad. And we had all the locks on the door, you know, the all the way up.
Yeah.
And I remember just having it open to the last two sort of chain links. And I said, fine, you know, 5 minutes, that's it. And I opened the door, and what I didn't know was that behind him were three other guys. And at 16, I was gang raped. And I think I would literally, when I describe it, it was a breaking. That's the only way I can describe mm-hmm. it. I've literally physically broke inside. Something snapped in me, and it just never, ever came back for years. I exited from myself. I was a shell. I was a zombie. When my mom found me, I was bleeding profusely in my closet, and we went straight to the hospital. And unfortunately, and this is not in honor of my mother, who's amazing. Sometimes we don't handle situations well. And as parents, sometimes there's some other things going on in your own past that we don't, as children,
know. Yeah, right.
So there was a lot of venting and projecting that was happening. This is your fault. You've brought this on yourself. How could you shame me? And so that, you know, when I speak to rape victims, I always say, what's worse than rape? And, you know, the room goes silent. And I say, rape plus betrayal. Because when you are in that place and you are broken and you're reaching and you're bleeding, to have people reject you on top of that, it's just too much to handle. I snapped. From the age of 16 to 19, I just started to run away and never come home and in and off the street. And it just, I absolutely had shut down. At that point, I became dead set on inflicting as much pain on myself as possible.
So those that hurt and are angry will react and hurt people. Hurting people hurt people.
Yeah. And the most dangerous place that hurt people can get to is when they move past hurting people to hurting themselves.
Yeah. So you are now, you're saying 16 to 19.
16 to 19 was the darkest period of my life. I went full-fledged into drug use. I did what I had to do to survive. I gave my body away because I felt at this point it had been taken from me so many times, I might as well give it away on my own terms and have my own control over it and use it to live. And I was filled with anger at that point. I had, in those 3 years, I had 3 abortions in those 3 years.
And what, Cheryl's in going through your head? Because those times when you're in your bed.
Yeah.
And you are thinking, and you're thinking about your life. And were there moments where you were like, what am I doing? Do I even want to be here? What's going through your mind at those times? Honestly, because...
I'm a mistake. God is punishing me. I brought this on myself. I will forever be used. I am a doormat for everyone. And I don't deserve to live. And I hate myself. I hate looking in the mirror. For the longest time, even after I gave my heart to Christ, I couldn't look in the mirror. And I couldn't be by myself because I hated myself so much. I even tried to take my life. I tried to, I was so high one day, I totally missed. I was supposed to go across my wrist and I ended up going up and down. I'm trying to get to my thing to show you. So I ended up just sort of, just slicing this way.
Wow,
because
yeah.
I was so
the scar's still there.
And I love it because I love that the scar's still there. Because
yes.
Every time I lift my hands to worship, I have a reminder of God's grace. Yeah.
So 16 and 19, you're running, you're hurting.
Yeah.
You're wanting to end your life.
Yeah.
But somewhere in there you found Jesus. And
yeah.
It's that's the thing, what I love about Jesus. Mm-hmm. In my own life is that you could be so far gone, or what society feels that you're so far gone.
Mm-hmm.
Even yourself, you could say, like, I am worthless and I'm nothing. But there's Jesus,
mm-hmm.
always there somehow, through a person, through a dream, through a feeling, through something.
Yeah.
What happened with you? Because somewhere along the line you found him, or someone shared him with you. When did that happen?
And that's what I love about God. He loves us so much that he will just go to elaborate lengths. to reach us where we're at. And he used a young man, a street evangelist, who just had a heart for street people and troubled youth. What a good moment for me to just encourage people that the person that you snub your nose at, and the person that you walk past and think, oh, their parents must be so disappointed. If you would just be bold enough and compassionate enough and listen to the voice of God,
mm-hmm.
you might hear, just tell them God loves them. It could change their entire life. That's what happened to me. This young man showed me the tangible love of God through relationship.
Mm-hmm.
What a powerful, powerful story for me, because he never really preached the gospel. He never gave me a lot of verses.
Mm-hmm.
He met me where I was at.
Yeah.
It was just a hot chocolate and a donut.
So you're on the street, and he came up. How did that happen?
It was just, he would always preach. He was preaching, always, usually in front of Eaton Center.
Yeah.
And just offered me a hot chocolate and a donut, wanted to talk afterwards. And that just went from there, just a couple of minutes. Every time he was there, just connecting, just hot chocolate, donut, just building relationship and not really getting into church, come to my church, here's a pamphlet, but just, hey, I see you, I hear you. We want to know, do you see us? Do you hear us? Because we feel invisible. And so he just listened.
Just listen. That is so key, because
right.
I find, and again, not a slam against the church, not a slam against Christian people, but
mm-hmm.
I find so often we want to just talk and get them into church and give them the pamphlet and do all these things, but a lot of times people just want to be listened to. They just want a presence with them, caring for their actual basic needs. Like, A donut, well, hot chocolate.
It's amazing because right? communication is two-way, right?
Right,
Melinda. So if you're only communicating in one way,
yeah.
you're living a partial life.
Yeah.
We do it in Christianity, our prayer. Hey, God, how are you doing? I love you. Father, I bless you. God, would you do this, do that? Oh, and listen, can you help, though? And so-and-so and sick and so-and-so. Okay, great. Thanks. Amen. And the Lord's like, okay. Next time.
Yeah.
Hey, God, how you doing today? And we do it all the time. We never stop to listen.
Yes.
And in conversations, mm-hmm. when we're speaking to those that are unchurched, we do all the talking. And we never say, hey, you know what? Actually, I'm here. I don't even have anything really to
say. And I don't have an agenda.
There's no agenda.
Right? Yes.
I've got nothing. I just wanted to know, could I just sit with you for 30 minutes? If you want to talk, if you want to cry, if you want to scream, I'm here. Yeah.
And it's not going to offend me. And I don't have an agenda that after I'm saying, okay, here's the answer quickly, and
yeah.
here's a pamphlet, or come to the church for Seeker Sunday.
Yeah, because we are not the answer. We have the answer, and there's a difference.
Beautiful. So he's sitting with you. How long did this relationship or this interaction go on?
It was about three months of just quiet relationship, meeting my needs kind of ministry. Yeah.
And what did that do for you? What was going on in your heart and mind as that was happening?
Well, love, you know, the Bible says that perfect love casts out all fear.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of love, that kind of practical, tangible love, it was breaking down my walls. It was slowly breaking down my walls. And it's like God knew that you couldn't come to Cheryl and just be like, hey, God loves you. And I would say, well, let me tell you about your God.
Right.
Your God abused me and Christian people, and I would have spewed hatred because I've had such a horrible experience. So this sort of just sharing time and space and just how are you? What's going on in your life?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're amazing. Do you know you're amazing?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know how awesome you are? And just pouring in, it just changed everything. And so finally, after about 3 months, he invited me to his church.
Mm-hmm.
By that time, I had warmed up enough. I said, I'm not going to a morning service. I'm not
too
gonna,
early.
Yeah,
I want to sleep in.
I got a party,
yeah.
and I got to do what I got to do.
Yeah.
And I just want to kind of pass in and pass out. I don't want to get into any sort of really heavy spiritual thing, but I'll just come. And I remember I went on a Sunday evening. He came and picked me up. He scooped me up. And that van was filled with the craziest types of people. There were drag queens. It was awesome. There were drag queens. There was me. There was another girl who's a prostitute. We're all there sitting in the van. And
what was that like? Everybody was like, what is going on, girls?
Head up to church. And this church, you know, when they see him coming, they were like, oh, here he comes. With all of the derelicts of society.
Yeah.
So we.
What a beautiful picture.
That's awesome.
Isn't that it?
Yeah, it's awesome.
That's what the church is about, is for all of us, all kinds of people to come.
Yeah.
Right? Come to the table, come to the church, hear about Jesus.
You know,
wow.
We focus on church being a meeting place, but if we could just get back to the church being a hospital.
Yeah. Yeah,
truly for the sick.
And we're all sick.
Yeah.
And we're all
mentally,
wounded.
Emotionally,
yeah?
And physically.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So you went to the church, and what happened?
Went to the church, and you know what was really interesting is that one of the things that this young man would always say whenever we kind of wrapped up our time together is he would say, okay, I'm going to get going now. Do you need anything? Do you want another, hot chocolate? Do you need any money for the week? Okay, I just want to remind you. And I'd say, yeah, I know. I can run, but I can't hide from God's love. Wow, what a statement.
Wow.
Because we're all doing that. You know, when we're broken and hurting, we're running from God's love. But you can truly never hide from it. And so that night, it was a Sunday night. I'll never forget. It was in November. I had quite a lot. I'm embarrassed to say how much, but a lot of drug money in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
And I was actually pregnant with the third pregnancy, which is a wonderful story I have to tell you when we get into the restoration part, because I didn't just get shiny and new.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It doesn't happen that way always. People
mm-hmm.
expect sort of this overnight.
Yeah, you make the decision and boom, everything's
boom,
good. And
yeah.
I've changed my thinking about myself and my actions and I'm all clean.
And I'm glowing like Moses from the mountain.
Right.
It doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
And I was pregnant with the third pregnancy and I sat down and I was broken and scarred. And the preacher was preaching just an old time sermon. You know, if the righteous are scarcely saved, where shall the ungodly appear? It's an old verse in the Bible. And he was talking about everyone falling and everyone being, you know, flawed. And then he stopped right in the middle of his sermon. I'll never forget it. And it was just one of those, I'm so glad I went to sort of one of those just spirit-driven churches, you know? And he said, there's someone here. He said, there's someone here. I don't know who you are, but, and they just start to cry. He says, but you've been through so much. He says, my God, he says, you've been hurt, you've been abused. And it was like, it was just sort of coming as a download. And he's like, wow, I just hear rape. I hear attempted suicide. I hear drug use. I hear depression. I hear alcoholism. Just going through the grocery list. Yeah. It was crazy. It was goosebumps, you know, the grocery list of my life. And he says, if you're here, I just want to invite you to come. I'm going to tell you the truth. I didn't go. I sat in that chair. I gripped it till my knuckles were like, you know, forming. And I just, I wouldn't move. There was such a war going on.
Oh, absolutely.
Right?
Imagine.
You know, and I always say this, if you were looking at me that night, I would have just looked like I was sitting sort of like this, Melinda.
Yeah.
But I was literally falling, trying to get, my heart wanted God. My flesh was like, no way. Mm-hmm. I've got you. Like, it's like the enemy is like, I'm keeping you, for myself. And I remember this. Don't you remember you hate God? Don't you remember what they've done?
What they've
Are
done
you going
to
go
yeah.
back to
yeah.
them? You're going to run back into them for them to hurt you? And it wasn't happening. There was no movement. And so I remember he turned and he said to this group of women, sort of elderly, can I get the intercessory team to pray? And I never knew what that intercessory
yeah.
word
what
was.
What does that mean?
What does that mean? But I just remember, can I get the intercessory team to just begin to start praying? We just want those walls to come down and we want freedom for this person. A couple of minutes after they started to pray, and they were praying up a storm, and a worship song just started to lift, and it was just this atmosphere of like love and God reaching me. I wasn't moving. I was not moving.
Still sitting.
Still sitting. And really at the point, it was like at the cliff of my life. And unbelievable, he turned and pointed. It's like he was just praying and praying, like, God, just give me a word, show me. Like, it was just that kind of, like, help me in the next few moments. And he turned and he pointed to me.
What? No way.
And, yeah, he did. He did. Oh, my goodness. And he said, you. He says, I don't know who you are, and I don't know your story, but God wants me to tell you one thing, that you can run, but you can't hide. The very same thing that I heard. Every single time for 3 months, I knew instantly whatever had been holding me, I was freed. I had been trying and wrestling so much out of my chair, Melinda. The church laughs about the story. I fell on the floor from the momentum. Like I had
really?
Been, yeah, because I had
been
really
holding
been,
back.
I fell and I just got up and I ran to that altar.
Wow.
I ran and I gave my heart to God. Let me tell you, I cried through that altar call. He finished his sermon. I was still there crying. They did the benediction, the closing. I was still there crying. We were in a school gym. Yeah. It was a school gym. It was a small church. Yeah. They were sweeping up the floor, packing up the chairs. Cheryl's still crying. And you know what? There's an old song that says, tears are a language that God understands.
Oh, yeah.
And I love that pastor. He's passed away, Pastor McEwen. But, you know, some of the mothers would go to just reach, and he would say, leave her there. He said, leave her. She's shedding the layers of her life.
I was going to say that from when you were
And he says, you have no idea the pain and all the injury. God is doing it. She's in He said, she's on the operating table. Leave her. Powerful.
Wow.
Yeah.
So from that moment, now again, you said it's not perfect. Like you make the decision and it was like a release. You needed to just like unload. God was listening, hearing, you're feeling the love. And it was sometimes people need that.
Yeah.
That response, right? That you need to physically get up out of your chair and make that.
Mm-hmm.
So from then on, what did your life look like? We just have a little bit of time left, but from that moment, what has happened? And the encouragement you would say to people who are listening and watching about your choice to follow Jesus, to make that decision and how that's changed you? Because you obviously are not the same person
No. So two quick things I want to encourage people on before I just wrap up with where I'm at. Never let anyone put a time limit on your healing.
Okay, good.
We do that to each other. Wow, I know your son died 5 years ago, but it's been 5 years, Sally. You know, you've got to move on with your life. And never put a time limit on people's healing. And that healing is progressive. Mm-hmm. It happens over time. It's not an instant thing. We set ourselves up for failure if we think, okay, God, I've got an addiction. I came for prayer. I feel better. So I'm going to leave this room and never want to drink again, never want to smoke again. And sometimes it's instantaneous, but sometimes it happens in layers. And so I gave my heart to God that night, and literally 3 or 4 days later that week, I had an abortion. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in my twisted, horrible thinking, I said, God, I've turned my life over to you. I've started this new chapter. I want to start fresh. Not understanding that God would have taken me the way I was.
Yeah.
He would have used, you know, the Bible says that what the enemy intended for hurt and harm, God turns it around for our good.
Yeah.
And what he could have done and would have done with that young child. And so I did that, you know, and in that, God has given me grace, and for the three angels that are in heaven, God has given me three angels down here, and I think of them constantly. And you know, from that moment, I just made a slow decision to continue to run after God.
Okay.
I made one decision only that changed my life. Every time that I get knocked down and every time the enemy knocks me down, God, I vow to you, I will get up. I was a fighter. I've always been a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the street in me.
Yeah.
I've always been a warrior. And so my determination to always get up, just I would get one step stronger.
Mm-hmm.
5 steps back,
yeah.
1 step stronger,
yeah.
But there was movement. And from that moment on, I dedicated my life. I went to Bible college, went to university, studied music. I'd always had a gift for music and the arts, studied musical theater, and had been asking God, like, how does this all come together? So this heart for ministry, this heart for the arts, is there a place that it can find a home? Because in churches, the arts have 2 slots, Easter, Christmas.
Yeah, right.
That's it.
Yeah.
And so I was able to use this arts ministry and really reach the broken. So we do films, we do plays. I have a Christian theater company and a film company that reaches our troubled youth. We're in prisons, we're in group homes, we're in schools.
Wow.
We've traveled to London, to the States, we've traveled to Africa, wherever we can go and put our feet on the ground. That's our stage, the Lord says. And so we communicate the gospel through the arts because it brings it to life.
Yeah.
And some people don't, you know, this generation has tuned this out.
Yes.
They're tired of the talking, but they'll come to a play. They'll sit and watch a film. And so they're getting the love of God in those creative ways. And I believe, lastly, that media is it's the 21st century tool of evangelism. It's where we are getting the widest platform and the greatest reach.
Beautiful. So. Wow, you are an inspiration, and what an encouragement to me even here to hear how God relentlessly pursued you.
Relentlessly, that's
and
the word.
And relentlessly pursued you. And for anybody who's listening and watching, you know, no matter if you think I'm worthless, I'm not seen, that you've been hurt and abused, you know, God is for you. He sees you and knows you.
Yeah.
And, you know.
And you're not forgotten.
And you're not forgotten. So if there are people out there that even just say, you know, God loves you, or even to see someone say, you know what, God sees you, knows you, do it.
Because
just like you, that young man on the street did that, and it changed your life.
Yeah.
As God was pursuing. So, Cheryl, thank you, thank you. Cheryl Nemhard, you can find you on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, right?
Yeah.
And I'll put up some information on my Facebook about you and the good work that you're doing. Thanks for being here in the studio
today. Thank you so much. What a joy.
Your Story with Melinda Estabrooks. Listen for new episodes every Monday and subscribe to the podcast at faithstrongtoday.com.